The next speaker we have is a filmmaker, an artist, a writer, and activist. She's affiliated with the Islamic Center of Rochester. Her name is Mara Ahmed. Good morning, friends and allies.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It does the heart good to see you all here today, the day after the inauguration of a new era in our country, albeit one fraught with very backward politics. I wanted to be present in order to march shoulder to shoulder with all of you and find strength in that solidarity, but also because I hope to break open this march, this rally, this wonderful gathering by including voices that are often excluded or even silenced. As a first generation immigrant, a woman of color, and a Muslim, I find myself at the intersection of some of the most reviled and vulnerable communities in this country. Not only are people like me perceived to be criminals and rapists who need to be contained within walls and borders, but we are also slated to be registered like so many would-be terrorists entered into government ledgers, watched and counted, and promptly roped off into segregated enclosures if need be. However, I want to make clear that this kind of hateful rhetoric, this debasement of language, but also ideas and policies, is not something that started with our new president. What we are seeing today is the result of decades of dehumanization, of surveillance, of no-fly lists, of indefinite detentions without trial, of racial profiling, of massive, massive deportations, and the never-ending and self-fulfilling war on terror. The normalization of war, of the killing and torture of black and brown bodies, is bound to normalize racism and violence everywhere. This is a connection that must be made. It's a connection that we must remember as we plan and strategize for our survival over the next 4 years. I know that many of you, just by being here today, are a testament to how we can all come together and how we can become a force for change. Let's keep this solidarity going. Let's talk to each other. Let's organize and resist together. But at the same time, let's also be aware of our differences. I say that especially to all my sisters marching here today in solidarity with the march in Washington, D.C. Let's learn from black, Chicana, and post-colonial feminists and refuse to otherize on the basis of race, class, caste, religion, or nationality. Let's not be maternal towards our black and brown sisters all over the world, but rather offer them support on their own terms by fighting against imperialism, wars, and racism right here at home. Let's remember Black Panther Assata Shakur, who said very simply, "We cannot be free while our men are oppressed." Meaning that as long as racism exists, And by that I mean structural racism, which manifests itself through ghettoization, racial discrimination, mass incarceration, and a racist criminal justice system. As long as racism exists, talking to women of color about patriarchy is a luxury. This is the kind of feminism I long for. A radical feminism imagined by Arab feminists as a concurrence of racial justice, gender justice, economic justice, and self-determination for colonized women, men, queer, and transgender people over here, but also over there. That this is a people's solidarity rally. I love that. That's the idea. Let us strive to learn from one another. Let us strive to learn one another's histories, our political realities, and our forms of struggle. Let us have the courage to recognize the racist infrastructure which undergirds global power. Let us forge alliances that are respectful of difference and confront all inequities simultaneously and exhaustively. Exclusion is not an option. Thank you.
BLACK, which is Building Leadership's Community Knowledge, please welcome one of the organizers, Ashley Gant.
Thank you guys so much. It's an honor to be here to walk alongside all the amazing people.
Louder?
Okay. I talk really fast, so I'm going to be deliberate about talking slow. Okay, louder. Okay. My 7-year-old daughter came home yesterday from school, and with a genuinely confused face, she said, "Mom, do you know what happened today? Donald Trump became president of the entire United States." Like, seriously? She was definitely confused, definitely shocked. And for the most part, that's my fault, because I refused to tell her that Donald Trump won the election. Mostly because I'm mad. Mostly because I'm still angry. Because I'm still upset that one of the most qualified candidates to ever run for presidency lost next to the most unqualified candidate to ever win. When I think about the president of the most amazing country on the planet, my hope is that he would be a symbol of hope, of freedom, of peace, of change, of self-control, of integrity, and of great character. The reason I'm upset about Donald Trump is because I don't think that, I'm sorry, the reason I'm upset is not because Donald Trump will have the power to carry out the egregious policies that he committed to throughout his campaign. I'm not afraid that those policies will be passed, despite both houses of Congress being controlled by the Republican Party. His platforms are largely unconstitutional and economically infeasible. But further than that, I want to believe in the structure of our democracy, that checks and balances will protect the American people. The reason that I'm upset is because of what Donald Trump's election means for the cultural climate of America. What levels of hate are not tolerable on public forums. What conduct against your fellow American will be overlooked. Black people, women, those who identify as members of the LGBTQ community, Muslim Americans, and the list goes on. Those people do not matter as others. Sometimes they don't matter as Americans, sometimes they don't matter as fellow citizens, and sometimes they don't matter as even friends and family. And that is the problem. That is why I'm upset. That is what is unsettling. It's unsettling that our country has voted and now deems acceptable the standard of conduct that is so intolerable it is an insult to human dignity and decency. I would not feel this way if another Republican candidate was elected. Conservative views don't move me, but they are valid. Hate, however, is not a political view, and electing Donald Trump was a social injustice. It is very disappointing to be black in America. And I know for certain that now since our new president has taken office, blackness will still not be on the agenda. A couple of months ago, the presidential debate included a section on racial healing. And for 20 minutes, both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton talked about policing black communities. We are not criminals and we are not dangerous. Many black communities across the country are plagued with violence, but that violence is a symptom of a disease system, a system that traps black Americans into a cycle of despair and has brought us to this moment where incarceration and death are interchangeable with the futures of our black teens. So as I listen to Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton talk about how we need to police our neighborhoods, how we need to re-implement the stop and frisk, and how we need to improve police relationships, I couldn't help but be disgusted. Why is it that the police officers that police our neighborhoods don't look like us and don't live in our own communities? One of those reasons is because black Americans are not part of the American community. We are citizens in limbo. We do not matter enough as communities to be seen as American communities. Black boys don't matter enough to be seen as American boys. They are black boys, and black is deemed as dangerous. For 20 minutes, no one mentioned schools and low-income neighborhoods. They never mentioned that they are underfunded, understaffed, and unacceptable. Yes. No one mentioned that the U.S. is providing substandard education to American children who happen to be black. And the lack of educational opportunity is having a detrimental effect on black communities. For 20 minutes, no one mentioned that black communities are being gentrified and black families who have lived in those communities generation after generation are being pushed and displaced. No one talked about the black and minority neighborhoods that are located in food deserts and the lack of healthy, fresh, and affordable food options that leads to poor health in black communities. When you talk about racial healing, it is not a conversation about community policing. It is a conversation about systematic oppression. It is a conversation about implicit bias and explicit racism. More than police officers who won't kill us dead in the streets. We don't need saviors. Black communities need an American system that we can thrive in. And we need a president who realizes that. We too are Americans. And unfortunately, our new elected president doesn't understand that. I realize that the things that I've mentioned here are only a portion of the difficulties that we face as a society. Let us stay strong and diligent in the upcoming days, weeks, and the years that we face challenging and confusing times ahead. If you are black, if you are Latino, if you are gay, if you are queer, trans, Muslim, Jewish, Hindu, an immigrant, a Muslim American, poor, a woman, a Native American, or any other minority or marginalized group, let us stand in solidarity across our differences of hate and bigotry. An attack on any one of us should be an attack on all of us. The hateful and oppressive forces we fear most must act as a catalyst for our unity across racial, ethnic, religious, and class lines. Our anxiety is growing as we approach the next 4 years, but let us channel that toward progress and reform. And most importantly, a resistance against the bigotry and challenges and the very values and liberty, equality, and freedom, and diversity that we hold so dear as Americans. Let us fight daily to be at the vanguard of resistance toward the movement of this Trump administration, fighting daily toward that realization of said values. If you're a teacher, use your classroom. If you're an activist, take to the streets. If you're a businessman, use the boardroom as your battleground. If you're an artist, expose the hideousness of hate through your art. If you're white, use your privilege. If you're rich, use your resources. In closing, I want to say one of my favorite scriptures. It says, love justice, pursue mercy, and walk humbly before your God. Black Lives Matter.
Jamie Romeo.
beast has to follow. There's no way I'm going to be able to measure up to that. I'm just going to say that. But thank you all for being here. And I just have to take a moment. None of us would be here today if it had not been in December a group of women that got together that said, this is not okay, and I'm ready to step up. And they became the citizens that President Obama empowered us to be. So let's all thank all those organizers right now. Thank you. Bringing us here today. We know that we don't agree on everything. There's probably a lot that we don't agree on, but we know that there are these common things that are bringing us today. And we know we need to fight for everyone's rights that's in this crowd, and even those that are not in this crowd today. But what's more important is that every one of you have a job to do in the future. We all have to stand up to be those citizens that President Obama told us to be. We have to be the ones that are creating the opportunities for people to come together and not just fight for each other and get active and get involved with a number of the service agencies in this community, but get political. And when someone says, you're being political, you say, you know what, damn right I am. Let's not be afraid of being called liberals or thinkers or Democrats or independents. We need to get involved in our political process. And the Democratic Committee is going to be here to do that for you. We are going to be there to make phone calls, to knock on doors. We need to talk to our neighbors, and we need to talk to all of our neighbors, just like we've heard other speakers speak up. Not just the ones in our bubble. This is a pretty big bubble right here, but I think we probably mostly agree with everyone here today, but we need to make sure, everyone, when you talk to someone that supported Donald Trump, let's find out why. Let's see what's going on in their lives, in their world. And you're not going to agree with some of them, but some people, just in the same way that a number of people are waking up to realize that Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act are the same thing. We need to have these conversations, and we need to make people know that it is okay to be political. It is important to get involved in that process. Register to vote. Register your family to vote. Make a plan to get to the polls. Run for office. We are here, and our doors are open, and we are ready to stand right there and fight with all of you. But we need you to show up. We need everyone here to not just show up at this rally, but to show up next week and make those phone calls. Have coffees with your neighbors and talk about what's going on in the world. Don't be afraid to say, well, that's political. I don't really want to go there. You're damn right it's political. Let's start talking about it. Thank you for being here. Thank you so much. Good job, dude. Thank you for your patience. Everybody. Our next speaker is somebody you want to listen to quite clearly. It's the chair of the board of the Gay Alliance, Colleen Ring. What it means to be a patriot in 2017. Woo! The people who formed this country and fought for progress risked comfort, friendship, family ties, freedom, and their own lives for the principles they believed in. They risked these things for their vision of this country, and now it is our turn. This is not Trump's America. This is the America of we the people. Hold the following truths to be self-evident. All people are created equal. And we all have the unalienable rights to life and the medical care that we need to live. The liberty to live free from discrimination and the threat of violence based on the color of our skin, our sexual orientation, our gender, our country of birth, or our spiritual beliefs, and the ability to pursue happiness as our authentic selves. We must not allow fear to silence us or to grow complacent with injustice. While tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands may loudly oppose these rights, we are millions. We must band our voices together and drown out hatred and injustice by by doing things that are uncomfortable and inconvenient. We must do more than wear safety pins and talk about these things on the internet. We must meet in person. We must call our elected officials often. We must encourage companies that we spend our money with to publicly support equality and justice. We must support our independent news agencies. We must use our voices to support every person and every entity attacked for speaking up and speaking out, because united we stand. We must move away from talking about how this happened and blaming each other. So when people say they don't believe with hate-driven policies, regardless of their politics, assume they are telling the truth and let them know how to help. When people want to stand on the sidelines or insist that we should wait and see, make clear that silence is complicity. Do this kindly and without accusation, but clearly. No rights were won in this country by bystanders, because patriots act. So I ask every one of you here today to contact someone you care about and get them involved. This is the hard work that changes the world, one heart and one mind at a time. And we must insist, yes, insist, that the leadership of this country speak out against bigotry. Yes. There should be no minimizing, no speculation about how few people feel this way. That doesn't matter. It's simple. Hate crimes and bigotry are against who we are as Americans. We must be true allies. We must make clear in our own lives that words of racism or sexism or Islamophobia or homophobia or transphobia or ableism or that are anti-Semitic or anti-immigration are not acceptable. When words, especially reasonable sounding words and nice words, are used to legitimize fear and discrimination, they will lead to hatred. And hatred will lead to violence. So we must make clear that we will stand by, no, not us, in this city of Frederick Douglass and Susan B. Anthony. So if when you heard about the civil rights movement, the women's rights movement, the gay liberation movement, the way during World War II, Jewish refugees were treated and how Japanese Americans were forced into internment camps, and you thought, if I were there, I would not have stood by. I would have stood with and for those fighting for their freedom. Now is your opportunity. Be brave. Stand up. Stand together, but refuse to stand aside. Thank you.
Friend of mine who worked on voters' rights this summer, and is at every event that I go to, whether Louise Slaughter is there or not, I want you to meet my friend, community organizer, Scotty Gannett.
Wow, look at this crowd. Give yourselves a hand, come on. I will never grow tired, neither should you, of seeing people come together to unite for civil rights, for equal rights, for women's rights, and the respect of others. Yeah! For some of you, this may be the very first time you've taken action. And maybe the very first time you put together a sign and you come to a rally like this. But don't let it stop you from continuing what you want to do. join and volunteer at an organization that's local that will create change in this city. You can be part of the world you want to live in and that I want to live in. There's a poem often recited by Martin Niemöller called First They Came. First they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I didn't speak out because I wasn't a trade unionist. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. Well, you know what? Let's change that. Help me out with this. First they came for the Muslim, and they came for the Muslim and said, here's a registry, and we stood in line, and they took our names too, and we speak out. They came for women's reproductive rights. Help me out here. We speak out. They came for the people of color who are unjustly slain in our streets, and we join together, and we speak out because Black Lives Matter. Then they came for the gay and the lesbian, the transgender, the bi and the queer folks, my community, and guess what? They burned our flags. And guess what, our community? We spoke out! They came for the immigrant. And we spoke out because our city is a sanctuary city. After we spoke out, we acted. We rally, we volunteer, we embrace our diversity because we are stronger together. And at the end of the day, when we've said, yes, we can, and when we've decided we are stronger together and we'll say, yes, we will, someday we'll look back at this moment and say, yes, we did.
Well, that ends my part. So I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being so supportive, so being so kind. And remember, kind. Let's all be kind to each other. I'm handing this back to Nikki. So thank you so much and be safe. Oh, thank you so much, everybody. We're going to move on to the second half. I do want to emphasize that it is 12:30. There's a half hour left. If you haven't had a chance yet, definitely head over to the church. There are tables from a lot of these organizations. You can get information, find out how you can sign up, become more active. Another thing that I wanted to do that I forgot to do during the introduction, I want to thank the sign language interpreters who all volunteered their time here today. It was pointed out to me, I have an apology to make, it was pointed out to me that I left out a mention of the voices of the disabled, and I apologize for that. I was trying to speak without using my notes, and I listed off as much as I could, but I do apologize for that. And we will have a voice from that community here very soon, so stay tuned. But to continue with all the talks now, the next person I want to introduce is Iman Abid. She is a local activist with the Islamic Center. Come on up.
As a country, we're still trying to understand what everything coming ahead truly means for us all. We're torn apart by the injustices we're seeing all around, and still we have yet to figure out what we exactly want as a country. This journey ahead isn't just an expedition that will test only our democracy, but it's a journey that will test our character. As a Muslim American and in Islam, we are shown stories in the Quran that teach us not only what we must do in the name of Allah, but what we can do for the sake of all humankind and what our character is like in the face of adversity. We are not tested in our good times. Rather, we are tested when we are being challenged most. In the last 24 hours, we've witnessed our new president being sworn in, taking an oath to faithfully execute the law of the land. Now, for many of us, this isn't the first time we'll be upset by our choice as a country, and it certainly won't be the last. What's important to remember is that these injustices have been around for centuries. that these injustices and violations of our rights did not roll on in the last 18 months, and that they are what they are now due to what we've allowed our administration to become. Let's just remember a few of the issues that we still face in this country. Flint, Michigan still doesn't have clean water. The Black Lives Matter movement started over a year ago and still continues until today. Women's reproductive rights have been challenged since Roe v. Wade, and Muslims have witnessed the highest spike in hate crimes since late 2015, and yet the list goes on. And still, we have yet to understand why others don't quite seem to get it when we ask them to suppress no voices and help minorities rise up. When I speak to you today, I'm not looking to the rest of the country. I'm looking to us to move forward as a city. I'm trying to help others see that with any more fractionalizing of this community, we'll fracture ourselves so deep. More than 50% of the children... More than 50% of the children living in the city of Rochester are living in poverty. And the overall poverty rate has gone from 16.4% to 17% in the last year alone. In Islam, when you pray, you are supposed to pray for others just as you pray for yourself. That individual goal you set for yourself will always lead back to the greater good of all humanity. But it doesn't just miraculously help others. You have to set it up so it does. You have to be conscious about your daily actions, the conversations you choose to take part in, and how you spend your time. You have to check what opportunities exist for you and that don't exist for others. You have to educate yourself on the needs of the people around you. And you need to spend some time seeing the perspectives outside your own. That means taking a commitment and focus on you like never before. On an everyday basis, I don't have to worry about my encounter with the police. I don't have to worry about making sure a location is accessible, and I don't have to worry about someone staring at me for the clothes I've chosen to wear. But still, I've chosen to check myself every morning. I'm given the opportunity to get up so that I may better understand where I am supposed to be placed in this world, while also trying to grasp how I may use my identity to help the communities surrounding me. Your role as responsible individuals begins at home in your very neighborhoods. We cannot see a change in the rest of the world if we do not create that change in our localities. What good is this world or this country if we don't change what's happening in our local communities? What good is it if we don't move past only celebrating the diversity of the city and not focus on the breaking down of systemic racism and oppression? What good is it if we never invite the voices of the vulnerable to the table? You have to start asking yourself some questions. Will you choose to speak up when you see something wrong? Will you choose to recognize that as we all stand here today, we were privileged enough to get the opportunity to be here? Will you choose to remember that as we stand here, a woman who is making below minimum wage in the city can't balance her fully put 40-plus hour work life while having to pay for daycare so she can take care of her family? One law and order may prevail in the federal government. We can choose to change what happens on our streets, in our cars, and on our sidewalks. If we fight together as one people and hold ourselves accountable to making change, your administration will begin to follow you instead of you following them.
Yes.
Don't underestimate your power and don't give up your power. I've chosen today and every day of my life that I don't want others to speak up for me. I want to be the only one to do that. Don't give up your power. Change doesn't come in a day or a year. It takes lifelong commitment. Always remember what greater good you bring, not only for your generation, but the generation to follow. Your own children and your neighbors' children could one day be facing a life of no injustices if you choose to fight hard enough. My faith has taught me to understand that when we feed the poor, the hungry, and the needy, we feed you only for the countenance of Allah. We wish you not a reward from you or gratitude. We teach one another not to only work within our own communities. In fact, we don't even look to ourselves as a different community of people. We rather look to ourselves as part of all humankind. When you choose to liberate a group of people who do not look like you, pray like you, or love like you, you succeed. I want my own sisters to feel safe driving down the street if they are in hijab. I want my parents not to worry about praying in public if they have to because someone somewhere wants to see if they're not radical. Don't stay silent, but remember that you have a duty to help others. I'm a Muslim woman who hasn't allowed fear to get to her. Rather, the fear has driven me to be louder than I've ever been before. I've chosen to stand up against racism, sexism, racism, Islamophobia, homophobia, and male, and will continue to drive this city to become a model for all other cities across the country. It is so important to remember that we need to continue fighting and to fight harder than we've ever fought before. Thank you to everyone who has been doing the work thus far, but please remember that you have to keep going. Thank you.